We are extremely happy and pleased to have Congressman Joseph Giugiardi as our first speaker this morning. I've had the opportunity to visit a little bit with the good congressman this morning, and I can assure you that he is 100% behind our program, and I'm delighted that he's with us this morning. Congressman Giugiardi was elected to the House of Representatives on November 6, 1984, to represent the 20th Congressional District of New York. With a strong background in accounting and business, Congressman Giugiardi has endeavored in Congress to establish himself as an expert on financial matters. God knows we need that from him. He has taken a leading role in accounting and budget reform, financial management improvements, and truth in government spending. This has led to the Congressman's selection as chairman of the Republican Research Committee Task Force on Federal Budgeting and Financial Management. Congressman Giugiardi serves as a member of the Banking, Finance, and Urban Affairs Committee, the Select Committee on Narcotics Abuse and Control, and the Government Operations Committee, which we are all, of course, very familiar with. As you know, Javits-Wagner Day Act falls under the jurisdiction of the House Government Operations Subcommittee on Employment and Housing. Congressman Giugiardi plays a leadership role on this subcommittee in his capacity as the ranking Republican. Congressman Giugiardi has shown a particular interest in our program. He attended and assisted in chairing the May 1987 oversight hearing on the Javits-Wagner Day Act. He has also had one of his staff people visit an NIB-associated agency for the blind, as well as the NIB Technical Center. We applaud the Congressman for his support. Congressman, we're delighted to have you with us. Ladies and gentlemen, U.S. Congressman Giugiardi.
Are not equally endowed. So we in government have to do something to make up for that playing field. And you know what I call that? It's helping people help themselves. We in government have an obligation to create a partnership with all of our citizens. And I say all of our citizens. And where a certain segment of our society needs a helping hand for whatever reason, so we can create that level playing field, we must do that. And that's what ACT does, that's what NIV does, and that's what all of you are here about today. Because you're fulfilling the dream of America. You are creating, in a broader sense, the United States of America as the greatest opportunity society the world has ever seen. I go back to the great Jewish philosopher, tell them that I support aid in Israel because it's important. But you know what else I'm going to tell them? That it's time that we help Israel help itself by getting better trade going. Because we want to make them a full partner with us, just like we want to make you a full partner with us. And you know what the great philosopher Maimonides said about giving, about helping? He said the highest level of giving, the eighth level as I recall, was not to give a man a fish, but to teach him how to fish. Make him your partner, not your ward. That's what I do. That's why I'm here today. Because I want you to understand. And I support your efforts 100%, 1,000%. Because you are a program that has to be done. Today in Washington, I am sick about the superficial, quantitative thinking I see brought to this budget process. There's a tendency in Washington to always want to do things across the board. We're not looking under the numbers. We're not saying these programs work, these programs don't work. I'm characterized as a conservative Republican, and I have called for a freeze in the military now for over 3 years because I see the waste. It was no shock to me to hear about what's going on now in the papers with this Pentagon business. And it's not just the I never ran for anything. You want to talk about an opportunity society? I never ran for anything in my life before I ran for Congress. People said, Joe, you're nuts. You can't get elected. You haven't worked for the party. You haven't run for any office. I did run for something. I ran for the president of my homeowners association. And it took me 7 years to get rid of that job, even as a congressman. But, again, if you work and if you dream, you can dream on that. And at the age of 43, dreams fulfilled, their oldest son, Joey, and my mom and dad walked the streets with me, with my brother and sister, and we took our case to a very tough district. Happened to have had a very liberal Democrat preceding me, and it's not easy when you go from one stream to the other, but we did it. Why? Because I didn't appeal to people based on issues, based on party platforms and platitudes. I went to them, no matter what their color, what their creed, what their party said, I share your value. I'm the product of America. Here are my parents. They never went past the eighth grade. America works fine if you want to become a partner with it, no matter who you are. And the values that I project, I believe no matter what you believe in, you will relate to these four values. Belief in God, belief in your family. You want to keep those traditional families together as much as we can. Whether you fall apart, we want to help you. Single-parent families, obviously, but the family unit is very important to us in our society. Society's weak when the family gets weak. Number three, that work ethic. We've got to provide opportunity for people to work. Why? It gives them dignity. It gives them self-esteem. It makes them feel good about themselves, and it makes their kids feel good about them. And that keeps families together. That's the work ethic that we started with over 200 years ago. Let's not lose it. I sometimes wonder where it is when I see that little company with their planning and their production and their savings mentality that we used to have. They're beating us not at their game, they're beating us at our game. We got to get back to those values. We got to save more. We got to produce, and we've got to plan. We used to do those things very well. We've got to do them better than you can. Because this is the society that's better. Plus, I'm concerned. Then that fourth thing. Spend all my Social Security money last month, 74, and I didn't spend the interest in my bank accounts. He wouldn't put his money into anything else because he came from the Depression, so he still had those bank accounts. In fact, the first one he opened up in South Bronx back in 1930, and said, "Joe, I'm leaving that there because I want you to have it with your brother Richie and your sister Angel." I said, "Dad, come on, let's spend it. You know, you've given us everything we need." Wanted to leave his kids a bank mortgage, and not a mortgage. And look what this country is leaving for the next generation today. We're now up to $2.4 trillion. That's why I came to Congress. I came to Congress because I felt it was time for someone who was trained 22 years, as I've been, as a certified public accountant. I was a partner in a major accounting firm. You probably know the firm, Arthur Andersen. I was a partner there for 12 years, started working as an intern. After working my way through college as a waiter, I was Joey the waiter for 4 years, working in those country clubs in Westchester County. When we moved there in 1957, I was 16 years of age. So I'm carrying forward my father and mother's dreams. But I'm not looking for anything to put anything in my hands, and neither are you. What I'm looking to do is to be a partner with government today. Even with what I'm doing, I can't do anything alone. And what you want to do today is to be a partner with government. That's all you're asking. Asking for a handout, you're asking for a partnership, and that is good, and that's a program that must survive, but it won't survive with the mentality that I've seen here in Congress. I just heard, as I came here early today, just to talk to your leaders to get a good feel, so I can speak not only from my head, but from my heart, because I never read from a speech. If I don't feel something here, I don't speak. I wanted to get that feel so I can come before you and try to make a before is to be alert that this is a very competitive environment and there are people who want to gain at your expense. They're not bad people necessarily, but that's the way they feel. And they shouldn't be gaining at your expense because from what I've seen, you are a good program and you're a program that deserves special consideration at all times so that we continue that level of playing field. How are you sure that you're heard? One of the things that you've got to do is not only support the NIV, but you've got to be an active participant in the NIV. Let me draw you an analogy. Last year, 50% of the people qualified to register in this country registered to vote. And only half of those voted. In other words, 25% of the people qualified to vote in this country last year. That is a bad sign. If we continue that kind of apathy and cynicism in this country, some special interest is going to get a handle on our system. And no matter how many checks and balances we have here in Washington, if we don't have the real power base represented, the people, and I mean represented broadly, there is going to be a problem. You have to support them because they're doing a good job. That's why I'm here this morning. I usually go back on Thursday nights with my family. I don't live here. I live in New York. I commute every week. But I felt this was important enough, so I stayed over last night. But you have got to feel that way, too, and I'm sure you do. That's why you're here. And what you've got to do is understand that in Washington, the squeaky wheel gets the grease. And it's not enough for a big organization and their attorneys to be approaching congressmen. You are the grassroots. There's nothing better than you sitting down for 5 minutes, taking your own personal stationery, and in your own handwriting, writing a note to your two senators, to your representative, and maybe the chairman of those committees that are important to you on both the Senate and the House. When that kind of communication hits the House of Representatives or the Senate, you know where it goes first? Powerful. no bones about it. Staff around here are pretty powerful. I'm a manager, and I have a tough time trying to control sometimes these staff from running off. Can you imagine these other congressmen? Brother, do you know that today there are only 5 certified public accountants in the entire Congress, including the Senate? That's 535 people. Guess how many attorneys? 260. That's a lousy balance when we're trying to balance the books. So what I'm encouraging you to do, which is what I'm doing right now with certified public accountants, because they are so underrepresented here, and their thinking is so underrepresented, because everything here is total reaction, robbing Peter to pay Paul, putting out fires, staying one step ahead of the sheriff. That's all I see here. And I'm saying that's not the way I was raised and trained. I was raised and trained to think beyond a year, to think 5 years. That's what Japan's doing today. You think they're interested in earnings per share? Look what happened this year with the value of the dollar coming down. They knew that they were going to take a hit because now it would be more expensive to sell Japanese cars here. What do you think they did? They lowered their prices to take lower profits this year because they're more concerned with losing the market. They're interested in market share in the long term, not earnings per share this year, and that's why they're knocking our socks off. Everybody wants to beat up on Japan. Sure, they have to open up all their markets and stop all their dumping. But guess what? If they did all of that, it would only reduce the deficit with Japan from $70 billion to about $50 billion, which we should do anyway. That means we're still alive. So I just use that as an analogy to say that we've got to get America thinking straight. And right now, you've got to get congressmen thinking straight. And when you send those letters in, and it gets to those chief of staffs, and those legislative aides, and those legislative directors, and they see a letter on personal stationery, handwritten, not a letter from, we want to get those anyway, but not just a letter from the association, and not just a postcard that someone signed, you can't send your agenda. That works, I know. At the end of every month, I get a talent from my staff, and they say, Joe, here's what we're getting this month. These are the kinds of letters coming in on these issues. And by the way, here's a batch of postcards we got. By the way, here's a bunch of well-written letters. Can you look at those well-written letters? Get some ideas, get some sense of what's going out there. Certainly become a full partner with America, and by being civically involved, you become a full partner with America. It's voting, and obviously it's being taken for granted. It shouldn't be. We should all be doing that. But go to the next step. Write a letter. And what NIB should be doing is giving you some letters that you can plagiarize. And feel free to plagiarize them. Everybody else does it. Don't put yourself at a disadvantage. Told you about how I came to Congress. The other thing I found out that was very shocking is that I did some research. I've only been, I think, 6, 7, or 8. We're not sure because it's hard to define how they classified those years ago. CPAs ever elected to Congress in history. That's 200 people. But one thing is for sure, I'm the only practicing CPA ever elected. The others only had 1, 2. Why is that important? It's important because you now know that there's someone in Congress on the inside who's been trained to think about accountability, to think fiscally responsible, to think in terms of putting economic reality on the books of the United States of America. And since I've been here, I have seen the opposite. I knew coming in that things wouldn't be so good. You can be sure when I got here, I wasn't disappointed. Because as I began to do my own auditing, not relying on all these audits that are done in government, I sensed that there is a system being used today that in many ways is designed to disguise. It's designed to help certain constituencies, and I think mainly political constituencies. And what it's doing to us all is it's preventing us from seeing where America really is today, so that we can begin to plan for a vision for America tomorrow. We're spending $1 trillion a year right now. That's the cash flow that goes through on the annual budget. We only raise $850 billion, as you know. And the difference between those two numbers is the annual deficit. accumulation of those annual deficits on a cash basis is now $2.4 trillion. Those are the bonds we had to sell to raise the money to make up the difference. That is the national debt. That's a very dangerous thing for America right now. That's a very dangerous thing for you. You know why? There's a tendency now for people to get frantic. And the tendency in Congress is, well, we got to start doing something about this deficit. And they love to wield meat axes in Congress because they're not trained like certified public accountants are to look under the numbers and make qualitative judgments as to what's working and what's not working. So the tendency is to throw a net out at across the board. And when you do that, you begin to hurt very essential programs like yours. My feeling is, take Graham Rutland. We had no choice but to do something with Graham Rutland. Why? The place was totally out of control. Sure, we needed to take a scalpel and go line by line to figure out what worked and what didn't work. But Congress refused to do that. And can we keep raising this national debt to the point where the interest on the national debt becomes $400 and $500 billion? You know what it is this year? $155 billion just for the interest. And we don't have that money. We've got to borrow the money to pay the interest on the national debt, meaning that we put out more bonds just to cover the interest. So now we've got interest on interest. When is that going to stop? That interest doesn't help anybody. It doesn't go to create jobs or housing or roads or any social welfare. Guess who it's benefiting? People with money. People can afford to buy those treasury bills. That comes usually from amounts of the poor people's money. And guess what's worse? It's going to the Japanese and the West Germans because they are putting their money here to fund our deficits. So we are decapitalizing America under our noses. So we needed to put the brakes on. And I reluctantly voted for Graham Rutland because there was no system of discipline here. That's not the answer. The answer is to get under those numbers and to make judgments. And the answer is, as I tell those generals that come before the Government Operations Committee when I see them, I say, don't tell me about another weapon system you want. I saw that Sergeant York gun that couldn't hit the target for $3 billion. We had to get a whistleblower. You're about to spend $11 billion and we cut you off right in your tracks. First weapon system they ever discarded. But it cost us $3 billion before they finally decided it couldn't hit the target. I wonder how many other Sergeant York guns we have in government. So the issue is, as I tell the generals, I know you need money. I believe in America. I believe in a strong America, but I don't believe in a spendthrift America. And you get the money for those essential programs from all those non-essential programs. Your program, my friends, is an essential program. You've got to be sure that as we deal with the deficit in this country, that your civic action and your professionals here are able to make the case that we've got to take money away from non-essential programs so that your program is not hurt. That's the challenge that you face this year. I'm going to help you face it. Why did I have to take this out? This is my voting card. Did you know that in Congress we need a plastic card? There's a computer terminal at the end of every row of seats, and it's democracy in action. When there's a vote going on, 15 minutes you got to vote, look up from the gallery and you'll see 435 names go up in lights. They're right behind that little screen. Lights dim up there and you see the names. And as your congressman or congresswoman walks in, they put this card in the terminal by their seat. And if they press yes, a green light goes up by their name. If they press no on a bill, a red light goes up by their name. And if they press present, it's a form call, it's an orange light. So I looked at this one day. I get a little allergy or something. I looked at this one day and I said to myself, you know, it looks like a credit card. I said, my God, it is a credit card. Because this card forced us to spend $1 trillion last year, and we only raised $850 billion. So I decided, I said, you know something, how am I, it was tough enough for an accountant to get elected to Congress. You can imagine what I had to go through. I couldn't tell people I was an accountant. I ran on a platform of common sense. All right, I figured, if there's anything, and by the way, Thomas Paine, who wrote that, remember the common sense pamphlet? He also wrote the Crisis Papers 200 years ago. He was a great patriot. Don't ever forget those Crisis Papers. He started off with the words, these are the times that try men's souls. Those words, to me, ring out today. But I announced my candidacy in my hometown, New Rochelle, in his cottage and museum, as the common sense candidate for Congress. And a year later, thinking of common sense solutions, it dawned on me that if I'm now going to take my message to the public so that they become a constituency changing this outrageous budget process, so that they know that we're spending their money in a good way, then I've got to communicate with them. It dawned on me that the best way to communicate with the public is using things that they understand. They don't understand generally accepted accounting principles and capital budgets and profit and loss statements and balance sheets, but they do understand a credit card, right? So I then decided to experiment with a message. Now, I'm now going to give you, after 18 months, a refined version of a message that I've taken around the country. This is now my national logo. I'm now on the cover of two magazines, not Time and not Fortune, Management Accounting and Chamber of Commerce. But we're getting there. But guess where I'm going after this? I'm getting on a 10:30 shuttle, and I have a luncheon meeting with the editors of Fortune at 3 o'clock in the time. And this is the message I'm going to give them. A little bit more sophisticated than this, but let me give you the bottom line. Because I expect to take this, and I hope to do, a video commercial after my election so no one accuses me of trying to politicize this issue, because it's not a partisan issue. And I'm going to try to alert America as to the crisis we face. Hopefully encourage them to do something by waving this card at them. And American Express has made my job easy because now you've seen all those commercials. You know who I am. Don't leave home without me. All right? Are you ready for take one? Here we go. You know, some people need that American Express gold card and its $10,000 limit to feel powerful. Others need that platinum card and its $100,000 limit to feel really powerful. Got a card that puts those to shame. My congressional opponent. Whether you live in my district or not, I care folks to impact your lives. My friends, take a good hard look at this card. This is the most expensive credit card in the world. This card has no limit. Now, I'm going to need 60 seconds. Now, when you or your spouse gets a call from American Express, Diners, MasterCharge, Visa, or whatever, and you've reached your $2,000 limit or your $5,000 limit, you know that economic reality has arrived. You sit down with the family, you look at your standard of living, you might even defer a vacation. Not with this card. Last year, we reached $2 trillion, the national debt. And what do? We just kept raising the limit, the debt ceiling. We say, pass it on. Let them pay for it. We've got a credit card mentality in this country, and we've got to take this card away from those legislators, Democrat or Republican, who are using it irresponsibly. Joe Cabrotti, CPA. Okay. Great. Now, I've got just one problem with this whole thing. I'm not going to find someone to pay for the ad. And I'll be doing that after my election because I think it's a message for America. Okay, two final thoughts. If there's anything that we're doing today with Javis Wagner, process making them feel good, in the process helping them fulfill their potential as human beings. I can't think of any greater role for the federal government to play than that role. I am very familiar with what you're doing. You heard one of my staff who went to St. Louis and brought it back to me. I'm delighted with what I heard. Another very good friend of mine who happens to be in the audience, Jim Kiola, or Don Fleming, I think is the company. He hadn't seen me in years. I only heard that his friend Joey became a congressman, but he came here and he's here today and spent the evening telling me firsthand. I never knew that his company was dealing with the workshop. So it gave me even a stronger feeling. Being here today, being here early to talk to your offices, see you personally, and now have a strong look down my life. You are right for America. And you've got to do everything you can to make sure that your program will not become hostage to the president. You didn't create it. Let's not let those people who created it now hold you hostage to their lives. The way that you do that is to become a big part of the Senate. My mom, by the way, I end with words that I'm not good enough to invent, but were invented by a great Englishman, and they were taught acting when he described our system. Because no matter how you complain about our system, never forget that to the rest of the world, this country looks like a torch on the top of that Statue of Liberty. By comparison, there is no better system. Lord Acton said that capitalism is the unequal distribution of wealth. Then he said, socialism is the equal distribution of poverty. Remember that. This is the system that works. Let's make it better. Thank you.